So for this episode of The Vote, we're going to be focused on town planning in a city, not just in Brighton, but other cities and towns. Sam Bagaeen, Hove Park Ward Councillor for the Conservatives. So let's start off with consultation. I know we've spoken many times before, town planning and consultation. Yep. There doesn't seem to be a lot of it going on in some big projects, not just in Brighton, but elsewhere. How do you marry town planning and consulting, you know, the people, charities, town, you know, planners and developers? How does that actually work in practice in regards to town planning?
So there's multi, thank you, Mark, first of all. So there's different layers, I think, to any consultation exercise. And you've got a lot of actors in that mix. And I think at the best of times, you want everybody to be pulling in the same direction. So take a big housing development on the western side of Hove, for example, towards Hove Valley. Okay, big development project, 880 houses. You'd expect some level of continuous community engagement and community consultation. The last meaningful consultation run by the developers for the local community is in Hove Park and in Hangleton and Knoll, happened in November 2018. Okay, so that's 2 years ago. So that's A, first of all, that's not good enough. B, all through this time, there's been various conversations between the developers, the planning agents, and the officers. And in some respect, us as ward councillors, but only through the planning officers. So no direct engagement at all with the planning team or the developers. So I've been pushing for the last few weeks, and hopefully we'll get a meeting in the diary for us. But I think what I've been saying for the past few weeks as well is we need to go beyond that. A, you've got communities there on either side of that King George VI Avenue who are very interested in what happens in that development, okay? So you've got individuals who care a lot and spend a lot of time emailing us, but then there's also the residents who probably know very little about it. So there's two levels of engagement there. Then you've got a third level of engagement, which is the diverse community that lives in Hangleton as well. And I feel that they're left out. So again, so we're saying, look, the four, possibly five ward councillors as well for those two wards, they need to be in with the planning agents and the developers soon. Now, the planning officers and the other officers at the council can talk all they want because there's certainly highways issues with that development. But I think it's important to take it to that lower level. And somehow, before the clock runs out and this thing goes to planning committee, we really need that grassroots engagement activity to happen soon.
Yeah. And does consultation achieve anything? Because they're going to build on Total Valley. It's been in the city plan before. So what can consultation achieve? Just minor tweaks, or can you get big change through consultation?
Well, there's meaningful consultation where you know they actually sit back and listen. And there's their statutory consultation, which, you know, our officers, bless them, they're happy to stand up at committee and say, well, look, we've done the statutory consultation here. That's fine. You know, we've ticked that box. We need to move on. I think there's still scope to change that, you know, because certainly there's so much that can still change about that development.
Yeah.
The other part of the consultation stroke engagement stroke learning is design review. Now, I've asked the council for, I think, the majority of the design review documentation that's come through over the past few months. A, we haven't seen it. I think I haven't asked for it, in all fairness, but it doesn't necessarily get sent to councillors on a periodic review and say, look, you know, us as a council, we contract this external body to run the design review for us so that projects are better. So, you know, we thought we'd share with you the minutes from the last meetings and these are the changes that happened. That doesn't happen. So I've now got in my inbox a whole stash of design review documentation. And I don't know if it's a coincidence or not, but this week we had an invite from Democratic Services pop into the letterbox saying, we want to brief you about design review and what's happening. So that's happening later this evening. You know. Yeah. So we need to make use of those vehicles that are available to us. And I don't think we do, because partly as elected politicians, we don't necessarily see that feedback and we're not then invited to actually sit back and listen to that debate that happens at design review. So that's another layer of consultation with local members, which is missing.
Yeah. So what can people achieve through consultation then? What you know, if people are really strongly object to, say, a housing development, yeah. What can be achieved through consultation? I mean, they do, I mean, do you have to, is it the biggest voice that wins the day, or yeah. What's the best way of approaching that for those people that are opposed to certain housing developments that are, for example, earmarked in a city plan, you know, on the urban fringe, for example, of Brighton and Hove?
Well, there is, I mean, the loudest voice normally gets heard, doesn't it?
Yeah.
But the loudest voice isn't necessarily where the power lies within that voice.
Right.
The power could easily lie elsewhere.
Yeah.
So what's holding up this project in West Hove is Highways England, because they basically said you cannot possibly take this to planning committee because of the impact on the strategic road network, i.e. the A27. Yeah. And until that's resolved, we cannot possibly let you do that. Now, that's held up. You know, it should have gone to committee, but that managed to hold it up. In a way, that's bought us some time. You know, so that power that lies with Highways England as a statutory consultee has effectively bought the community time to stand up and say, well, hang on, now it's our turn. You should come in and talk to us. Now, whether we can do that before this thing goes to committee, I don't know.
Okay? Yeah.
But then there's the other bodies. We're trying to give teeth to the Hove Park Neighbourhood Forum, you know,
yeah.
Because that is a body that I think the officers would listen to if it was up on its own 2 feet. And we're working really hard. We've got, you know, we've got 3,000 leaflets hitting Hove Park this week, you know,
yeah.
Asking people to sign up and register in addition to our existing membership
yeah.
List. We got held up during the pandemic, you know, the worst of lockdown. But I think now we really need everybody behind us, and that, you know, that is a body in planning law. You know, if we had a plan, which we don't, but we're in the process of making one, then officers would actually have to pay attention to that. But it's a long way to go before we are actually taken seriously and have some weight in the way planning decisions are taken.
So if you set up your own association, then that has weight in planning law, then they have to consult local, so, like, you know,
I mean, it's look,
resident associations.
Yeah, so you've got residence groups,
yeah.
You've got the Woodland Drives Committee, you've got the GBRA, the Goldstone Valley Residence Association, so you've got all of these organizations, but actually the one that has the clout in enshrined in planning law is the Neighbourhood Forum.
Yeah.
And in a way, that's what you set up with a view to setting up a neighbourhood plan. And that's the one
yeah.
That gives you the best chance, I think, over time to deal with any, if you like, consultation issues or any changes that you think are necessary. Now, we've obviously got the planning white paper and all of that's going to
yeah.
Get mixed up again. But I think under the current system, this is the best vehicle that the community has.
Yeah. Just before we finish for the end of the break. So how, you know, we've got this target of 16,000 houses that are in the city plan too, yeah. To be developed. Building on the urban fringe, I mean, it seems that cross-party, or at least I know the Greens, for example, are advocating building on certain parts of the urban fringe. Whitehall Kill, for example, I know in Patcham and Hollenberry yeah. On the fringes there. So that is very much part of people's ideas now, isn't it, to kind of build on the edge of the
yeah.
City.
Yeah.
Is that always a good idea, or are there any kind of red lines?
Yeah. Well, there's two things to the housing debate. First of all, there's the numbers, you know, and what our projected numbers are now. And you know, they're at officers' minds because they mentioned them at every planning committee. And what the projected numbers could be under current proposals, okay? So there's two things. There's debate about the actual numbers. I think the last number given at one of the previous planning committees was misleading and wrong. Certainly our targets are not up by 287%. That's not true. I think it's worth saying that.
Yeah.
That's just scaremongering. The other thing that I think you need to do, and this is where the Greens are probably, in my opinion, you know, barking up the wrong tree, in effect, is that, you know, they're being myopic in how they're tackling these. You know, they're focused on one thing at any given time, you know, waterhole rewilding, you know, but then you forget what's happening elsewhere in your system, in your network. And that's wrong, you know, because what you need to do is you need to think about your gains and losses across the city. You know, it might be that you gain somewhere, but then you have to be prepared to lose somewhere else.
Yeah.
And the same way, if you gain somewhere else, you have to be prepared to kind of, you know, bite your losses elsewhere in the city. And you cannot lose sight of that systems view. And you know, we've got individual battles going on. You know, rewilding waterhole is great, but what's going to give in return? Something has to give. And we're not talking about what that give is elsewhere in the city.
So town planning's basically a bit in the city, it's a bit like a jigsaw then. You've kind of got to, it's got to be one full picture, and not everyone's going to win, are they?
No.
They will be losers, basically.
That jigsaw, I think, when we talk about the planning white paper, that jigsaw is the exact image as to why the planning white paper is probably good for the city. We've been briefed heavily against it by officers already, but that's not necessarily true. Again, that's a myopic view of the planning white paper.
That finishes the first half nicely. So I'm going to be speaking to Sam a lot more about the government white paper on planning in the second half. Join us then. So back here for the vote with Sam Bagaeen, Hove Park Ward Councillor for Brighton Hove City Council. We're talking a lot about town planning consultation first half. Second half, government white paper on planning. What's it all about from the basics?
Thank you, Mark. So it's an interesting one, this, because we've had all sorts of, you know, briefings and counter briefings in favour of and against the white paper. And I've sat in on a lot of webinars, including by the people who actually wrote the white paper, and kind of beginning to understand some of the rationale behind some of the proposals. I mean, there's an easy one and there's a difficult one. The easy thing to talk about is design coding. You know, it's part of the design coding underpinning the planning white paper is the Building Better, Building Beautiful Committee, which is the Roger Scruton work, you know, and the Nicholas Boyd Smith work that the government commissioned. And that underpins, if you like, the beauty and the design elements of the planning white paper. Now, we've tried to do a design code for Hove Park through our neighborhood forum. We're now having to chuck that out the window because I've come to the conclusion that we can't actually reconcile what we want to do with what officers and other members envision for Hove Park. You know, we've certainly had some really random and ridiculous decisions from, you know, allowing things on gardens to allowing things to be demolished and replaced by things that look exactly the same, you know. Perfectly entitled to, I think, in some of the reasonings, but not in others, you know. I mean, we've had our residents being called snobbish for wanting to keep the character of the area as it is, which I don't think was fair.
Yeah.
But we're now gonna go back to the drawing board on the design code and actually try and work up exactly what we want things to look like.
Now,
the government's vision for the white paper is that design coding will underpin what you see in the various zones that are being projected.
And there's three zones, isn't there?
It's three zones. Yeah. So there's growth, renewal, and protection.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, the easiest way to imagine this, I think, in somewhere like Brighton and Hove is, we talked about the jigsaw before. I don't see it as a blanket thing, i.e., you know, this part of the city is for growth, this part of the city is protection, and this part of the city is renewal. It's not going to work like that. The way I think that will work is if you take individual parts of the city and you go, well, within this part is for growth, this part is for renewal, this part is for protection. So that when we get, you know, ridiculous planning applications that say we want to replace these family homes and Goldstone Crescents with flats, actually we could say, well, fine, if this area is marked for renewal, then that's all right. If we mark it for protection, then you can't do that.
Yeah.
And in a way, you've got to go down to individual streets and neighborhoods and say, this neighborhood, this street is for renewal, this street is for protection, this street is for growth. And I think only if you do that, A, will you give people the voice as those decisions are made, because that's currently not happening at the moment, because the argument goes, well, if you do a blanket zone, then you're taking people out of the equation. Actually, that's wrong, because if you take the decisions on zoning locally, then people will have a voice in whether their street is for protection, for renewal, or for growth.
And will there be consultation on what your area is graded? Who's going to do that grading? Who's going to, because that's going to be a big debate, isn't it?
Yeah.
What zone you're going to be put in?
No, and this is going to be part of the big debate. But this is the big debate that our officers need to take a proactive role. So rather than already briefing against the planning white paper, as they've done, is effectively say, well, we're going to stand up and we're going to be proactive and we're going to take a big map of the city and we're going to begin to draw up indicative areas for growth, renewal and protection, and then we're going to take those down to local communities for big consultation exercises. That's what you would do.
Yeah.
And that's what you should do, I think. Now, whether that's the kind of activity that's envisioned later on, I don't know, partly because the planning white paper is a collection of ideas. You know, it's a text and people are writing in with comments. What we really need to keep an eye out for is the legislation that then drives it,
yeah,
which should go into effect in 2021.
Next year.
So that we have effectively new planning legislation in December 2021, if the calendar, you know, if it's along the timeline that I think it should be along.
Okay. And what about the role of councils then? Because I spoke to Councillor Cyril Hugh-Jones about this, yeah, in the past. David Gibson, Councillor David Gibson, for the Greens, they're quite critical of it, yeah, of this white paper.
No, but I mean,
because they're saying it takes power away from the local councils.
It doesn't, because it asks that local councils actually stand up and speak up for their own communities. Now, you're not going to sit back and wait for government to, you know, government isn't going to come in and say, Brighton and Hove, you know, all of Brighton is designated for renewal. You know, it's not the government that's going to do that. It's the people of Brighton and Hove and the elected members and the officers that are going to do that. They just need to get their act together, stand up and actually say exactly what they want. And it goes back to that previous point, which is, look, this is not about, you know, all wins and all losses. You know, this is about what's happening across the whole system, what's happening across the whole Brighton and Hove ecosystem. Where are we willing to give? Where are we willing to take? Rather than, oh, we're going to take everywhere here. I mean, the cycle lanes are very good examples. You know, it's take, 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 you know, not willing to give an inch. And that doesn't work. You know, you've got to be willing to give and take. And you've got to kind of open up. You know, we've got, unfortunately, we've got a myopic leadership group at the moment, you know, partly because they're focused on this one thing, you know, which is, you know, let's all be green. I mean, effectively, you know, if government shifts the goalposts next week, I think next week we've got a new green incentive scheme coming up. You know, there might be nothing to it, but there might be quite a lot of things that we can use locally. You know, it might effectively change, you know, some of the stuff that we're doing. So yeah, you've got to be willing to adapt, rather than simply go head in and say, well, I'm going to do this no matter what.
Yeah.
You know? And I think you've got to be, as the leadership, instructing the officers of what your vision is. If you don't have a vision and you're waiting for the officers to give you a vision, we're not going to get anywhere.
Yeah.
We're going to be in the same place we are today in over the next 5 years. You got to have a vision. You know. So forget your election manifesto. What actually is your vision for the city and for the various parts of the city? You know,
yeah,
unless you articulate that, we're not, like I said, we're not going to get anywhere.
Is there an upper limit on the housing capacity in Brighton? I mean, do we have to keep on expanding Brighton? I mean, do we need to make it into kind of a greater Brighton? I know there's talk of a greater, yeah, Brighton authority now, yeah, which would have, you know, up to something in that direction, yeah, and bring in Lewis as well, if that ever comes to fruition. So do we have to be constantly expanding? Is that part of the government's kind of idea about, you know, town planning reform?
I mean, we could have an elected mayor if we wanted to. I doubt that we will, because I think, you know, a whole bunch of people said they didn't want one for the Greater Brighton area.
Yeah.
But there is a Greater Brighton Economic Board.
Yes.
There is a Greater Brighton Economic Board infrastructure panel, which I've sat, yeah, on for 2 years. And we now have, we had a meeting last week. So we have a whole raft of projects on water and energy, if you like, not housing per se, but actually, you know, the basic infrastructure that's going to underpin everything that we do. The trick now, the one thing that we are missing is the funding. But actually, this is where I said to the group last week, this is where we need to be innovative. So, you know, why don't we invite the people who run the green bonds and the municipal bonds to come in and actually talk to us about what options we have to fund these things,
yeah,
rather than sit back and say, well, what government pots are available, you know? We've got assets that we can use to leverage our own funding.
Yeah.
And I think we don't use the tools that we have effectively enough. So we need to do more of that. Now, housing figures, standard methodology 2, which is how housing needs are calculated, underpins the planning white paper.
And these are really crucial decisions. That,
yes,
it's normally the planning inspector, yeah, has the final say. Is that right? Or the,
yes,
government.
I mean, there is an ongoing debate about whether any inspector presence. You need two rather than one, but that adds cost and so on, just so that you kind of get that playoff against each other.
Yeah.
But, you know, we've got a housing target that's likely to increase because the algorithm says it's going to increase. But again, you're then hitting the levelling up agenda north-south and where the housing numbers will be. For us down here, it's where the jobs are going to be. Where in Greater Brighton are the jobs going to be? Because that's what's going to drive the housing. If there's no jobs, then there's no housing.
Yeah. Okay, just before we finish up then. So what do you the tan and white paper, I mean, where, going forward, I mean, what's they're in consultation mode now, aren't they? So they'll be listening to all different sorts of groups. I mean, we've seen some big infrastructure projects getting the approval despite quite a significant amount of opposition. HS2, for example, you know, that's gone through. So is the government's vision to kind of provide housing for all? I mean, is housing their main kind of driving ideology behind the white paper? They just want to get houses and people houses. Is that what's driving it?
So housing is one. Right. I mean, HS2 is one of the big infrastructure projects which come under...
Biggest in Europe, I think.
You know, and it comes under, effectively, the National Infrastructure Commission. Now, we've got a big infrastructure project in North Kent, along the Thames estuary, for example. That's a big development area. It's one of the biggest development areas in the southeast at the moment. So you have this, but you've got different bits of legislation dealing with those. Okay, I think what's important, the Planning White Paper consultation finishes at the end of October. Write in with your comments, say what you want, what you don't want, and then let's take a look. Yeah, you know, if you look at housing numbers, I think yesterday I saw a figure 380,000 permissions given but not built.
Yes.
So you gotta go back to the building industry and say, what are you doing?
Land banking.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's more, you know, it's more land value uplift, if you like, which should go to local communities. Yep. But then again, what is your local development model that allows that kind of uplift to be then kept for the local community? You know, what are you proposing? It's all right to criticizing other people and what they're doing. What are you doing in Brighton and Hove, for example? They say, we're going to propose this, we're going to use the money for the community.
We'll leave it there for now. We're going to be carrying on this discussion in another episode of The Vote. So that's it for now. Samer, thanks for coming in and join us again soon.
Thank you, Omar.